Good afternoon. Thank you for the invitation, Dana. I'll start with the problem. The problem is ALS, one of the, you know, there are no good diseases, but ALS is really a terrible one. And I'm sure that you have heard about ALS. You can see a weakness in muscles, muscle spasms, weight loss, paralysis. And the big problem is the prognosis, which is very short. About 2 to 5 years after the diagnosis. In Israel, there are about 1,000 patients. In the United States, about 30 or 40,000. And actually, there are no cure. There is one poor drug, riluzole, but it really doesn't show any good effect. And the main problem is that the motor neurons from the spinal cord degraded. We don't know why, but we can point that the most of the motor neurons from the spinal cord and later on from the brain, from the motor cortex to the spinal cord, degraded. So our approach for many years is to try to develop stem cells approach in neurodegenerative diseases, and one of them, one example that I want to show here is ALS. If you look on stem cells in general, the alternative stem cells are embryonic stem cells because you can get very early a stem cell that can be differentiated to many cells, and we can get it from the embryo or from cells after induction of four genes, the Yamanaka approach. And actually it should be a very good candidate for therapy, but the main problem is embryonic stem cells are that by definition, if you inject embryonic stem cells, you get tumors. And of course, you don't want to risk the patient. So even if you have one undifferentiated cells in your therapy, it might be very problematic. So there are many ways to try to reduce the number of undifferentiated cells. But still, what we can see from the field that the very, very few stem cells therapy based on embryonic stem cells. This is also the political problem, and as you can see, the colors and the more dark are more liberal, and Israel is one of the most liberal state concerned using of stem cells in general, in research, and also in therapy. So from the beginning, we decided not to use embryonic stem cells, rather to use adult stem cells. And adult stem cells, there are several advantages. One of them, that you can get stem cells from this to differentiate to several directions. But the most important thing is they are very safe, and you can use it, especially for autologous transplantation, very easily from the patient to treat himself. And the type of cells that we choose is mesenchymal stem cells. There are rare population in the bone marrow. Most of the stem cells in bone marrow are for the hematopoietic system, but very rare of this population are mesenchymal stem cells that can differentiate to several types, but we look for the cells that might be better than only mesenchymal stem cells by itself, and I'll show you later. We don't know exactly what is the goodies that are in these mesenchymal stem cells that you can see improvement in several indications and many experiments, but we know that the cells reduce apoptosis, induce neurogenesis, secrete neurotrophic factor. So all of these are parameters that are important in neurodegenerative diseases, so we thought that these cells might be a good candidate for treatment. And indeed, when we look on the field of clinical study, we can see this is the increased number of clinical studies. So this is mesenchymal stem cells, and you can see it increase every year, and we now have hundreds of clinical studies using mesenchymal stem cells as compared, for example, to embryonic stem cells, which are excellent, but we don't see it in the clinic. There are only very few clinical studies using embryonic stem cells, and I think the main problem is the safety that I mentioned before. So we have mesenchymal stem cells in the clinic in many countries, including in the States and Europe, where it's a tight regulation. And all of these studies show that mesenchymal stem cells are very safe. But we want them to treat the CNS and go into the brain and show neuroprotection. So to do this, we chose them to secrete neurotrophic factor. And this is here the list of the neurotrophic factor function. And as you can see, they are very important for the old function that you can see in the CNS. The question is how to get this factor. And indeed, several clinical studies already use neurotrophic factor in studies, but all of them failed. And the excuse were that we don't know exactly which factor to use, how to deliver the neurotrophic factor. And the main problem is that once you inject proteins, the neurotrophic factor or proteins, they'll degrade very, very fast. So we look for two approaches to bring this neurotrophic factor into the brain. The first that I want to describe here is the astrocyte-like cells from mesenchymal stem cells. And on the left, you can see mesenchymal stem cells after we isolated from the bone marrow and from the first experiment we start from human mesenchymal stem cell, which is also a good decision because later on it was found that human mesenchymal stem cells are different from from rats and mice cells. And after looking for many protocols, we found that this specific protocol can induce differentiation of mesenchymal stem cells to cells that are look like astrocyte and show expression of a specific antigen or specific protein, which are astrocytic proteins, and they express produce neurotrophic factors like GDNF, BDNF, and IGF-1 that we know from many, many experiments that those neurotrophic factors are essential for neuroprotection or for maintenance of the CNS. And we look not only that for production of this protein in the cells, but of course we like them to protect the neurons, so they have to secrete. So by ELISA, we can see that in the supernatant, we can see increased amounts or levels of these factors after growing the cells or differentiating the cell in this specific protocol. And here we can see the for GDNF as well. We checked in several models. I want to show only one model, the rat sciatic nerve injury. And then, as you know, the sciatic nerve is the largest neuron in the body. And what we did is we crush the sciatic nerve, and day later we inject the mesenchymal stem cells after differentiation and before differentiation in this lesion site. And as you can see, this is the crush in the rat. And here we can measure, we measure the motor function of these rats before and after. And we can see about 50% reduction in the motor function as measured by rotarod. This is spontaneous recovery by, as we can see, after saline injection. And the red line, you can see that when we inject the mesenchymal stem cells after differentiation, we can speed up the regeneration of this sciatic nerve injury. And we can see it more pronounced on the when we did EMG on the specific leg that was injured. So this is EMG of a normal rat. This is after injury. This is after injection of mesenchymal stem cells. And here after injection of mesenchymal stem cells after differentiation. So we can see that indeed the differentiation of these cells can improve the regeneration of this sciatic nerve. We use this specific differentiation, these cells, in several other models. Here we can see for Parkinson's disease, and again we can see improvement in this model. Then we use it in another model for Parkinson's disease using 6-hydroxydopamine. And in optic nerve transection, we inject it into the eye, and we can see a recovery of the optic nerve. We can see it also in a model for multiple sclerosis, sciatic nerve injury, as we mentioned before, and in two models of Huntington. So we have here a platform of cells that can secrete neurotrophic factor, can from the human bone marrow mesenchymal stem cells. So this platform can be used in the indication that you want to recover or to speed up the regeneration. Actually, in this point, we approach Ramot and say that, okay, we have some potential pattern. And our philosophy is that you don't run to pattern, you run for findings. And once you have the finding, we think that it's not moral, immoral, not to write a pattern. Because if you not write a pattern, nobody will gain from this important findings. Because if to develop a drug costs about more than $1 billion, nobody will invest in your finding if they don't get the rights on the pattern. So we wrote a patent and established a company named Brainstone that was mentioned before by Shlomo, and to take it from the lab to the industry, you need a lot of modification. One of them, if you can see here the speed of the growth of the cells in the culture, you can see that by modification of several factors, you can increase exponentially the number of the cells you can grow in this dish. Another problem, for example, in the lab you can use the cells and can grow the cells with antibiotic. It's most of you doing in your lab. In the industry, or if you take the cells to the patient back, you cannot use antibiotics. So you have to do it in clean room, and it's very expensive, very complicated. So indeed, we established a clean room, and it was very hard work to grow these cells and get a high number, and to check it if it should be very, very sterile, of course, before you go to the patient. And then we build the clinical study with Adassa, as was mentioned before. And the idea was to choose the patient, which was a very hard task, but for the physician, not for us. And then 2 months later, after we follow up the patient, we take the bone marrow inspiration with the mesenchymal stem cells, do the differentiation, and 1 month later, which means 3 months after recruitment, we start to follow up the patient, and every month they have to come to the clinic to see the changes or to take all the parameters. We inject about 100 million of cells mainly intrathecally, to the spinal cord, and the idea is that the cells will go through the CSF. Some of them might also penetrate into the brain. One of the first experiments was done as outside of the clinical study, in one patient that we follow for his severity, the ALS score that I will mention later. This was his situation when he came to the treatment, and immediately, or after a few weeks, we can see very nice improvement. Now, this is very rare to see improvement in ALS patients. Actually, it was never reported. Then we see some reduction in this performance, and then he came back and ask for another one. And here you can see another treatment with the same cell that we were prepared before. And again, we can see another wave of improvement, which is we're very happy to see it. But here we can see the performance before. We have to copy this draw before treatment and after treatment. So you can see the improvement. Then we move to the big experiment with about 30 patients. And one of the release criteria is to show that in each patient, you have to show that your differentiation process works. So if you compare the red bars to the blue bars, this is before and after the differentiation. And we look for several neurotrophic factors. So we can show that in all of the patients, at least four neurotrophic factors, we see increase at least by 4 or 5 in each of these neurotrophic factors, which means that this differentiation process ex vivo can work and you can increase the levels of a factor. Now we are ready to go back to the patient. Of course, the first question and the main question was safety, because this was the first clinical study using stem cells after differentiation. All the hundreds of clinical studies use mesenchymal stem cells as is, taken from the patient and go in the culture and go back to the patient. Here we did some differentiation, which of course changed the fate of the cells, and it's not easy to bring it back to patient after this differentiation. We're happy to see, okay, that indeed no side effect. And of course we look for the efficacy, and we look for the score of the ALS here, and the vital capacity, which means the respiration, and sorry, we don't see the graph, but we can see that 87% of the patients show improvement in this clinical study, which is we're very happy to see it. And we also show local benefit when we inject it into the arm. And now, as Shlomo mentioned, we have another clinical study in the state with 48 patients. This is a very complicated experiment because here, this is the first stem cells clinical study using placebo, which means the patient doesn't know and the physician don't know. And you can imagine ALS patients that are treated for 1 year and it might be their last year, and they are injected with saline and not with the real treatment, but this is the requirement of the FDA. Okay, in 4 minutes, I'll give another approach for the same problem. And again, we want to bring neurotrophic factor into the patient or into this model. And here we say, if you really can bring the neurotrophic factor through the muscle, why not to use the muscle stem cells? And together with Professor David Offen from the Weizmann Institute, we have muscle stem cells here. And then the muscle stem cells were injected with the 4 genes for several different neurotrophic factors. So now we have genes and cell therapy together. We have the stem cells from the muscles and the gene for neurotrophic factor. We have 4 populations. And then we check whether they can improve indeed after injury of the cells. And you can see all the different combination of this population of induced or engineered cells. And you can see on the right that only if you induce the cells with 4 neurotrophic factor, we can see the improvement, which means that we can see synergistic effect of several factor. Again, I'll show you on the same model of a sciatic nerve injury, and here in this time we inject the muscle stem cells with the 4 genes, and what you can see here, this is the saline, and this is an improvement by each of the gene with the stem cells, but only the mix of 4 population of stem cells with the 4 genes, we can see the high improvement. And you can see it also in the tissue. And when we checked it in ALS model, which we see after 3 or 4 months, we can see paralysis, and after 5 months, all of them died, we can see whether we can improve the survival of these mice. So again, we look for the motor function. This is after injection of saline or virus with GFP virus. But here we inject the muscle stem cells with the genes. We can delay the onset of the symptoms. And most importantly, we can increase the lifespan of these mice, which means that these 4 genes, when we inject it only to the legs, can increase the survival of the mice, which is very, I think, impressive. So again, we can see that using stem cells here with genes can improve the motor function and the survival, and we hope that these cells can be also used in clinic. And recently, we licensed this technology to stem cells medicine, and we'll take it to some indication of nerve injury in the hope that soon we'll have them, these cells also in the clinics. And all of this, of course, can be done only with a wonderful group that we have in the lab, excellent student. They are dedicated for the science. But on their way, we have also patent, and we want to bring this finding into the clinic. Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to be here. Dana invited me as a scientist rather than administrator, but since Shlomo Nimrodi made such a nice introduction for the Blavatnik Center, I really encourage you, especially the graduate students in biology, chemistry, engineering, medical sciences, to visit our website, Blavatnik Center for Drug Discovery, so it's bcdd.tau.ac.il. It's really a very exciting initiative funded very generously by Len Blavatnik, and we do hope that we could change the culture of drug development at the Tel Aviv University campus. It's not for those experts in drug development, to the contrary. Our aim is to help those who have new targets, new enzyme, new receptor, new biological mechanism to come and translate it into some initial lead compound that could be later developed by using all the wonderful mechanisms that Shlomo Nimrodi mentioned. So you are very much encouraged to contact us. Please visit our website. So, as Shlomo said, I served with all kinds of different positions and jobs. This is the reason that I would give you also some my a little bit complementary view about the way that patents and the IP issue should be developed at the level of the university. We have a relatively large group and publish in good journals. We have 34 families of patents, so I guess that we are holding something like 5 or 6% of the patents of the university because we are working on very different fields. And I would also like to give you the understanding that there's no one precise way or right way to go with the development of intellectual properties. You can go through the mechanism of licensing to a pharma company, or in case that it's not pharmaceutical development, to other entities. You can go through the establishment of a startup company, as just Danny just mentioned. And sometimes you want to go to one direction, you ended up in another one. Our most advanced program went all the way from novel chemical entity to the completion of phase one clinical trials for the treatment of AMD, age-related macular degeneration. But in the short time, I would like to give you more of the flavor of what we do and how we do it, and how you can work on different subjects with that are very diverse. So a little bit about the science. What are we? Are we interested in those activities? How did we get there? So we are learning and being inspired from nature. We are looking for the most fundamental recognition modules within biological systems and non-biological one. We are interested in the way that molecules, especially biomolecules, interact in the process of molecular recognition and self-assembly. So we are dealing with the most fundamental questions in molecular biology, biochemistry, to find the way in which way form-ordered structures would take us to many different directions. I would try to convince you that excellent basic science is really the tool for most direction. Are using the reductionist approach, we identified extremely short self-associating motifs, as short as dipeptides. For those of you are everybody are all the students are biologists or okay. Most of them, dipeptides, very small, two amino acids, and even single amino acids and nucleobases, which for us is a new paradigm for inborn error of metabolism disorders. I will mention it in passing just to give you insight also on the science. We can also form all kinds of structures at the nanoscales. These structures have unique mechanical, physical properties, including mechanical one, optical, piezoelectric, semiconductive. Once again, I would like to convince you that if you are going into fundamental questions in science, you end up with the discovery of new directions, which could also lead to the development of new products. A very interesting point for us is the fact that our approach, a reductionist approach, is a very systematic, reductionist, non-biased. So we take complex questions, we cut it, or complex system, we cut it to smaller and smaller pieces, trying to find the smallest module that can allow a growth. And time after time, we discovered that structures that we identified in a systematic way were used over and over by nature in independent development, which is, in this case, is the self-assembly of guanine, which you know in the molecular level, it formed the G4 quadruplexes. But on the level of organisms, it forms a physical colors in fish. It forms the mechanism of color change in chameleon and reflectors in reptile eyes, such as crocodiles. So we are now our very, just this morning I discussed this with a multinational company, one of our very last discovery, which was published, Nature Nanotechnology Advanced Materials and patented, is to use guanine-derived structures to make all kinds of optical activity. So you don't, even if you're dealing with biology, you not always end up in biology. And so there are many directions. Some of the examples of the things that we were doing in drug development, by identifying minimal recognition modules that facilitate amyloid self-assembly, we're able to develop a drug candidate that is now in a clinical phase for treatment of AMD. We have a preclinical licensing for a drug candidate for Parkinson's disease, signed quite recently. That's with the middle of 2015 with Dexcel Pharma, the manufacturer of Dexamol. They are now, I think they say it on public, as Teva, they want to move from being a generic drug company to innovative one. As far as we know, they signed three projects for varicopaxone, and one of us, of the projects is ours, so we are very proud. And the other one was already mentioned by Shlomo Nimrodi. It's our agreement with Ari Pharmaceuticals to develop therapeutic agents for AMD, age-related macular degeneration. Other direction, and I'm using it since everybody, all our biology students, also to, although we have a patent on this, I'm not sure how we can. I always believe in patents, and as I will mention later on, there's some urban legend that you cannot publish if you write patents. This is completely non-true. We publish in good journals, and we always patent our discoveries. Sometimes we license it, sometimes we are less successful in licensing. This is also something that you have to take into consideration. Shlomo Nimrodi mentioned it. Many times you fail. Many times you start with one thing and you end up with another thing with a great success. I mentioned the Copaxone of Teva, developed by Michael Sella and Ruth Arnon at the Weizmann Institute. Already sales of about 30 billion US dollars. I don't know what is the royalty, but I can assume that it's somewhere between 3 to 5%. The scientists get about 40%. You can make the calculation for yourself. It's quite a lot of money. But they didn't want to make a drug to treat multiple sclerosis. They wanted to have a peptide model to induce multiple sclerosis. This was the starting point. The starting point was in the 60s. The drug was approved in 1996, about, yes, 30-something years later, when Michael Sella was already retired. But still, so this is the business of drug development. Here I mentioned that we went to smaller and smaller parts. Our recent discovery is the ability of a single amino acid to form ordered amyloid structures, probably related to inborn error of metabolism disorder. And we are trying to change the way what we think about amyloid disease. Lastly, I mention it by being inspired from nature and starting the smallest recognition module. We got into this field of organic nanotechnology. I want also to show my video. So.
Molecular self-assembly plays a central theme in the organization of biological systems. Building blocks interact via non-covalent bonds to form well-ordered assemblies at the nanoscale. The Gazit group at Tel Aviv University have used a reductionist approach to identify very short recognition elements that facilitate the self-organization of proteins into functional nanoassemblies. We have identified very short peptides, as short as dipeptides, that can rapidly and efficiently form discrete nanotubes of unique physical properties. By molecular engineering of the basic recognition module, we were able to obtain other architectures at the nanoscale, including nanospheres, nanoplates, nanodots, and hydrogels with nanoscale order. We noted the key role of planar aromatic moieties in the acceleration and stabilization of peptide self-assembly. Not only were we able to obtain various architectures, but also organize the assemblies into ordered arrays using diverse methods such as physical vapor deposition, unidirectional physical growth, and inkjet printing. This results in a high-density array of peptide nanostructures of remarkable regularity and immense functional surface area. The peptide assemblies and arrays possess unique physical and chemical properties. This includes remarkable mechanical rigidity comparable to steel, luminescence in the visible range of the spectrum, piezoelectric properties comparable to the best inorganic piezoelectric materials, and semiconductivity. Our quest for the most fundamental elements of molecular self-assembly opens a new front in organic nanotechnology. The application of the nanostructures and assemblies includes light-emitting devices, ultra-sensitive sensor, energy storage devices, and novel reinforced materials. A new and very unique organic nanotechnology platform was developed. This proprietary technology may change the way that we think about nanoscience and nanotechnology. Only the sky is the limit for future applications.
I want to convince you that you never know. What you need is to really ask the right question, being innovative, and look for interesting phenomena and questions. And there are many applications, as I mentioned, for those structures. Recently, I mentioned the guanine. This is really very recent. So in our, I spoke about peptide structure and peptide nanotechnology. In parallel, there was quite a lot of work on DNA nanotechnology. So we're showing for the first time the ability to use PNA. These are structures that have peptide backbone and DNA side chains. We're showing that guanine, let's go to my third or fourth slide, that only guanine-based structures could form ordered assemblies. We solved the crystal structures, and as we could conclude, like we thought we'll have interaction, Watson-Crick interaction, like DNA on the one end, stacking, like we see with proteins on the other, making structure of unique physical properties. And very, very recent, just published a few weeks ago, going into even smaller structure, guanine-based PNA building blocks could form uniform spheres that forms ordered array. Those in the front could see these are thousands or tens of thousands of small structures arranged in some hexagonal spacing. And while we were about to publish this work, it was a work published by a group in France on that just discovered what is the basis for the changes of colors in chameleons. So like the guanine-based crystal structure that we found in the chameleon, think about it. They need to change very rapidly the color of the animal. So the way that it's been done, there are guanine-based structures that serve as photonic crystals. They scatter only part of the light, and based on the structure, on the size of the structure as well as the spacing, and then by adding some changing the ionic strength, by increasing or decreasing the concentration of sodium ions, you can even have the crystals coming closer together or apart. And then the animal can quickly change the color, and we can do it now with our photonic crystals. So I'm trying to convince you that just explore science for the interest of it. We didn't plan to have color changing structures. But we ended up with something that reminds us of the chameleon. Now we are discussing way to use it. Think about it. It's probably the only way to achieve. You can have photonic crystals by the use of silica beads or other beads, but this is done. This is formed by self-assembly. This is probably the only way to achieve color from just a transparent solution by self-assembly. And then you can tune the color. So this is what we discussed now. I would like to share with you some basic concept as I see on commercialization. I think, and I mentioned it through my short presentation, I think that the prime goal of research university is pursue excellent research at the highest level. Commercialization is the second phase. If you are only concerned with commercialization, probably your science will not be as good as if you are interested in basic science and excellent basic science. And I think that in most cases, successful IP out of universities was coming from leading labs that were interested in the most fundamental questions in basic science. Excellent basic research could lead to excellent translational research, but not in all cases. In some cases, the science could be excellent, but it won't be lead to you shouldn't judge. Now I'm wearing my vice president hat. You shouldn't judge by the only the product of commercialization. This is something that I already mentioned. And if somebody tells you something else, please send them to me. There's no reason that protection of IP will hamper any publication of a research activity. There are mechanisms. You can file provisional patent application within days. I don't know any situation in which a paper is published within days. Even in the most successful review process, it takes weeks or months. You have enough time from the submission of the paper until its publication to protect your intellectual property. This is really a misconception that I would like to like to change. And I think that scientists interested in commercial development of the products of their research could find a way to achieve both publications as well as patent protection. Shlomo already mentioned it. There are several options for commercialization. Licensing of a technology to a large company is the best. Well, it's a very good avenue. There are some problems with it. He mentioned, I think that both myself as Danny had experience with the technology that get into a large company. Due to all kinds of reasons, we had you get it back, you need to repackage it, you need to relicense it. And with a large company, you are much less of control with your intellectual properties. Because I can tell you about one of the cases. I think we had a very excellent technology licensed to medium-sized pharma company, which was it's a private company. They decided to change direction because of some internal decision not related to us. So we had to take the technology back and relicense it. We can establish a startup company. You heard the successful experience of Danny, and we are now experiencing these activities. You can have technology maturation in framework of the university, momentum found, the things that we heard, as well as sponsored research and options. So another option, and as Shlomo Nimrodi said, this is very much more common in the US than in Israel. You go to a large company, they pay you to do the research in the university. If the, the fruits of the research are of use for the company, they have the option to license it. So I think that these are the four ones. Licensing, as I said, it seems like the most lucrative one and the best for the scientist. From our experience, people see the equity of a funded company. They have 40% of the startup company. By the time that the product is in the market, if the product is in the market, they are diluted to such a tiny part that getting royalties from a large company is much better, in most cases, much better direction. Again, Shlomo already mentioned it, but I want to give my point of view. I think that, and this is for you as a tip, if you are inventors, you have all kinds of entrepreneurs, serial entrepreneurs, they made it, it's their fourth or eighth or 12th company. But there's nobody who knows the understand the technology as the inventor. And in the case of licensing to a startup company, they need you. They need you as the inventor, also if you are not the leading founder. And Tel Aviv University, we allow the inventor to have executive positions, such as chief scientific officer or others in the company, take advantage of it. And actually, in the right agreement, some of the research activity could be done at the university or hospital or any institute. So I think that this is also very important. We are already out of time. But we have some examples of the... one example is the EG30, which I mentioned. We started, I will mention it just in a nutshell. We started as a, and you know, time, we need the 35 years for the Copaxone. if we reach the something even that is similar in a small scale to this success, but... In the last 8 years or more, we started with funding from a technology maturation program to develop a drug to treat diabetes, to target amyloid formation in diabetes. We had then had a very opinionated and intelligent board for this virtual company, who decided that it's much better to go to Alzheimer's disease, because at that time, 8 years ago, 7 years ago, Alzheimer's disease, it was very much pursued by all major pharma companies. By the time that we reached phase one clinical trials, there are three failures of these drugs to treat Alzheimer's disease, although the drugs that failed represented technology of 15 or 20 years old technology. But then, so we moved to AMD, age-related macular degeneration, but now we may move back to Alzheimer's disease, because one innovative company, Biogen, proved that actually this approach of targeting inverkase by antibodies, we use small molecules, is maybe a correct one to treat Alzheimer's disease. So now we are looking at this as well. This is the way that it moved. The motto of our lab is simplicity is the ultimate sophistication. As you can see, we're working with very small structures, and of course, this is a work of many talented students, and this is the link to the website of my lab. Yeah. Any questions?